Hello students, welcome to Zoology classroom. This is L. Mahesh, Assistant Professor of Zoology, Para Government College. In today's class, we are going to discuss about transport of oxygen. This particular topic belongs to final year BSc Zoology, 5th semester. So before entering into the topic, let us know why oxygen is needed to the organism. Oxygen is very, very essential for all living organisms, including plants, animals, and microorganisms. Few exceptions are made for this thing, which can live without oxygen. They are called as anaerobic organisms. Whereas remaining all other organisms, they are aerobic organisms, aerobic respirators. They require oxygen for their living. So why oxygen is essential for all these organisms? In last classes, we have seen that oxygen is very, very important for the liberation of energy from food materials. We know that food materials give energy for us, but that energy will be liberated from those food materials only when the food is reacted with oxygen. That means oxidation of food materials only delivers the energy which is there inside those food materials. So for this purpose liberating energy, releasing energy from the food materials, oxygen is very, very important for all organisms. So, how this oxygen is utilized in releasing energy from the materials? We have seen that respiration can be divided into three phases: external respiration, internal respiration, and cellular respiration. Real respiration or oxidization of food materials takes place inside these cells and particularly inside the mitochondria. So here in this diagram, we are seeing this thing, this mitochondrial inner membrane, inner mitochondrial membrane, and this one, this outside thing, it is an intermembrane space. After this space, there will be outer mitochondrial membrane. And this side of this inner mitochondrial membrane is the matrix, mitochondrial matrix. So outside of this outer mitochondrial membrane, that means inside the cytoplasm, glycolysis phase will be done. And the final products of glycolysis are pyruvic acids. That pyruvic acid enters into this mitochondria. And across these two membranes, outer mitochondrial membrane and inner mitochondrial membrane. By crossing these two membranes, the pyruvic acids, they will enter into this inner chamber of this mitochondria or mitochondrial matrix. So inside the matrix, there goes on this Krebs cycle. And in the Krebs cycle, NADH, FADH2 will be formed. This NADH and FADH2s, they will participate in electron transport chain. Electron transport chain is present in the membrane of inner mitochondrial membrane. So when these NADH and FADH2, they will lose electrons and they will release hydrogen ions. And these hydrogen ions will be sent into this intermembrane space, into this intermembrane space. And these electrons will be transported over this electron transport chain. And there will be some electron transport chain complexes, namely ETC1, ETC2, ETC2, and ETC3, and ETC4. Like this, the electrons will be transported over this electron transport. And what happens as a result of this dehydrogenation of NADH and FADH2, what happens, hydrogen ions will be accumulated in the intermembrane space and electrons will be transported over this electron transport chain. So when these electrons and when these hydrogen ions are coupled with oxygen, so here in this diagram we can see in this reaction, two hydrogen ions and two electrons plus one oxygen are of oxygen molecule. When these three react with each other, water molecule will be formed. So only when water molecule is formed, here in the oxidative phosphorylation reaction, ATP will be synthesized. So for the synthesis of oxygen, for the synthesis of ATP, oxygen is very, very essential. When there is no oxygen, hydrogen ions cannot form in, they cannot participate in the reaction to form water molecule. For this purpose, oxygen is indirectly, it is being utilized in the ATP synthesis. Oxygen is not directly synthesizing the ATP, but oxygen is being utilized in the synthesis of hydrogen, hydrogen oxide, dihydrogen oxide or water molecule. So in this way, oxygen is very, very essential. When there is oxygen, then only this ATP will be formed in fourth phase of cellular respiration called as oxidative phosphorylation. So this is the use of ATP. This is the use of oxygen. When there is no oxygen, energy releasing process cannot be fulfilled. So how this oxygen being uptaken by the unicellular organisms like protozoans and some multicellular, early multicellular organisms like porifers, how they will receive oxygen from the surrounding medium. So as these are very simple organisms, and in the case of protozoans, they are having only a single cell, so that from the surrounding medium, they will easily, they can easily absorb oxygen via concentration gradient. That's the concentration gradient. Oxygen concentration will be high outside the protozoan body, and carbon dioxide concentration will be high inside the protozoan body. So that according to this concentration gradients, carbon dioxide will leave the protozoan body and enters into the surrounding medium, whereas oxygen enters into the protozoan body from the surrounding water medium. So in this way, exchanging the respiratory gases. So here carbon dioxide is the, waste product. In the glycolysis phase and in the Krebs cycle phase, we have seen that one glucose molecule will be broken down into six carbon dioxide molecules. So those carbon dioxide molecules are not useful for the body. In fact, they will be harmful if they are going to stay for a long time in our body. They will increase the acidity in our body tissues. So the increased acidity in the body tissues will become harmful. Our body. For that purpose, carbon dioxide has to be eliminated from our body. That's why that is a waste material for our body. So this carbon dioxide has to be sent out and oxygen has to be taken inside the body. This is called as exchange of respiratory gases. The exchange of respiratory gases is very easy in this primitive organisms, in unicellulars and primitive multicellulars like porifers. Why? Because almost all body parts, almost all cells in their bodies, they are in direct contact with the surrounding medium, so that exchanging materials with the medium water is not a problem for those organisms. But whereas in the case of multicellular organisms, this process is very, very difficult. Why? Because as we can see, right, starting from this cnidarians, And coming to this, big sized some reptiles and mammals, all other organisms, they have got a big sized bodies. So these big sized bodies led them to a condition where all their body parts are not in contact with the surrounding medium. And whereas many of these organisms, they have adapted for terrestrial life. So in the terrestrial life, the surrounding medium will be the atmospheric air. So all the cells, they cannot receive oxygen from the surrounding atmospheric air. So for that purpose, for supply of oxygen, a special system has been developed in those organisms that is called as a respiratory system. In aquatic animals, there may be gill system or there may be some other type of gill-like system, gill-like organs will be there in them. And whereas in the terrestrial animals, some of them have tracheal system, like as we can see in insects and higher level organisms, we can see a pulmonary system. So whatever the system may be, it may be the purpose of those respiratory systems is to send oxygen into the bloodstream remove carbon dioxide from the blood and send to the exterior. So here in this diagram, we can see that this is the end part of the lung and alveoli and alveolus, and this is our blood vessel, which is in close contact with this alveolus. So blood is flowing inside this blood vessel, there is carbon dioxide more inside this blood and more oxygen present inside this alveolus air. So in this alveolus, from this alveolus air, oxygen enters into the blood and carbon dioxide leaves the blood and enters into this alveolus air. So in this way, exchange of gases takes place. This process is called as external respiration. The external respiratory movements, inspiratory movements and expiratory movements, they will help for this exchange of gases. Coming to the internal respiration, in internal respiration, what happens? blood returns from the lungs with full of oxygen and it reaches the tissues. When it reaches the tissues, it gives the oxygen to the tissues and receives carbon dioxide from the lungs. And again, by taking carbon dioxide, this blood returns back and finally it reaches the lungs. So this process is called as internal respiration. So in internal respiration also, exchange of gases is taking place, and this exchange of gases is occurring in between blood and tissue. So here the present topic, oxygen transport comes into picture in this phase only in internal respiration. How the oxygen is being absorbed into the blood and how the oxygen is being transported till this tissues, that makes the essence of our topic. So for the carrying of oxygen, a special type of protein called hemoglobin is very, very helpful. And this hemoglobin is present in the red blood cells of our blood. So respiratory pigments, hemoglobin is a respiratory pigment. Some other organisms, they have got some other type of respiratory pigments like hemoerythrin, chloroporphyrin, like that. Different types of respiratory pigments have been evolved in different types of animals. So these the respiratory pigments are very, very important in transporting respiratory gas, especially oxygen, from lungs to the tissues. So in this transport of oxygen, in next class we are going to discuss about transport of carbon dioxide. So be it oxygen or carbon dioxide, in transporting them, partial pressures are playing very, very important. So first of all, let us know what is a partial pressure. So partial pressure is the pressure that would be exerted by one of the gases in a mixture if it occupied the same volume on its own. So we know that our atmospheric air has a definite amount of atmospheric pressure value, and at the sea level, at the median sea level, it is 760 mm per hg. So this 760 mm per hg atmospheric pressure is the total result of the all type of gases which are present in the atmospheric. So then partial pressure will be the partial pressures will be different for different type of gases which are present inside the atmospheric air. For example, in the atmospheric air, we know that around 78% of nitrogen is there and 21% of oxygen is there. So out of this 760 mm per hg, 78% of that 760 mm per hg would be the partial pressure of nitrogen, whereas the 21% of that 760 mm per hg pressure will be the partial pressure of oxygen. So in this way, partial pressure is considered as the pressure that would be exerted by one of the gases in a mixture if it occupies the same value on its own. And this partial pressure will be mentioned as the PO2 is of partial pressure of oxygen, PO2. In case of partial pressure of carbon dioxide, it is mentioned as PCO2. So in a mixture of gases, each constituent gas has a partial pressure, which is the notional pressure of that constituent gas, if it alone occupied the entire volume of the original mixture at the same temperature. The total pressure of an ideal gas mixture is the sum of the partial pressures of the gases in that mixture. So in this way, partial pressure of oxygen plays a very, very important role in transporting oxygen from lungs into blood and from blood to tissues. So oxygen partial pressures will be varying in different parts of in our body. In the alveoli, the oxygen partial pressure would be around 104 mm per hg. And whereas in the arterial blood, that comes to the lungs, the oxygen partial pressure at PO2 would be around 40 mm per hg. So in this way, at the lungs, when the blood is coming from the body, when the blood is coming, the blood coming from the heart will have 40 mm per hg partial pressure of oxygen. Whereas in the alveolic air, the partial pressure is around 104 mm per hg. So there is around 80 mm per hg difference is there. So in the alveoli, oxygen partial pressure is high. But in the blood, at length, the oxygen partial pressure is low. So in this way, there is a big difference. This big difference lets the oxygen enter into these arteries. So in this way, the blood will be oxygenated. So oxygenation or exchange of atmospheric gases, exchange of oxygen into the blood and carbon dioxide into the alveoli occurs just due to the partial pressures. So we will come to know about the differences in partial pressures of carbon dioxide in next class. We are not bothered about that topic in this class. So in this way, there is a difference between these things. So as a result of this exchange of gases, what happens? Now the blood will become more, it will have more partial pressure of oxygen. So that when it reaches the tissues, air at the tissues, the cells of the tissues, they will have 40 mm per hg oxygen partial pressure. But the blood returned from the lungs via heart will have more oxygen partial pressure. So now the blood is having more oxygen partial pressure than the tissues. In that way, then what happens? The oxygen will leave the blood and enters into the tissues. So in this way, oxygen entering into the blood at the lungs and oxygen leaving the blood and entering into the tissues made possible only just because of the differences in oxygen pressures. So oxygen transport, oxygen is carried by two forms through the blood, and one form is that oxygen is combined to hemoglobin 97% of oxygen transport is made possible by this method only. And the second method is called as oxygen dissolved in the blood. So 3% of oxygen will be dissolved in the blood plasma. As oxygen is a gaseous material, and blood is having plasma, in plasma water is there. So oxygen gas can be dissolved in this water. So in this dissolved condition, 3% of oxygen will be transported from lungs to tissue. But mostly 97% of oxygen will be transported by combining with the hemoglobin. And this, when the hemoglobin is bound to oxygen, then it is called as oxyhemoglobin. So oxygen transport through hemoglobin, so in this hemoglobin or ESP, it forms oxyhemoglobin. Coming to the structure of hemoglobin, actually it is a complex protein. It is a conjugate protein which is formed by the fusion of protein, globin protein, with the ferrous molecule. Atoms. So in this way, it is a conjugate protein, and it is also called as ferroprotein, as it is having ferrous thing in it. And its molecular weight is around 68 daltons. And there are over 500 million hemoglobin molecules in each red blood cell. And oxygen and carbon dioxide will be bound to this hemoglobin. So in this way, hemoglobin is considered as a respiratory pigment. Why? Because it gives a color to the blood. Due to the presence of hemoglobin only, blood will get the color. That's why it is called as a pigment molecule, and it helps in the transport of respiratory gases. Hence, it is called as a respiratory pigment. And the normal ESP concentration is around 13 to 15 grams per deciliter. That means in a liter of blood, around 130 to 150 grams of hemoglobin will be there. So the main regulator of hemoglobin production is a special type of hormone called as erythropoietin. And this erythropoietin is also mentioned as EPO. And this EPO will be secreted by kidney in response to tissue oxygen levels. When tissue oxygen levels are low, kidney produces erythropoietin. This erythropoietin triggers the production of hemoglobin. So when there is more erythropoietin, more hemoglobin molecules be produced. So when more hemoglobin molecules are produced, it can bind with more oxygen molecules, then the tissues will be able to get more oxygen. For that purpose, it is like a chain reaction. So, and oxygen transport through this hemoglobin molecule consists as a hemoglobin molecule, it is having four oxygen molecules in it, so that each hemoglobin molecule can bind with four oxygen molecules. Why? Because each hemoglobin molecule is having for ferrous ions. So, and hemoglobin oxygen binding. But the main factor that drives the oxygen to bind to hemoglobin is its partial pressure. So, the difference in the partial pressures of oxygen results in this binding of oxygen with hemoglobin at lungs. But the relationship between partial pressure of oxygen and oxyhemoglobin binding is not proportional. So initial binding of oxygen is difficult, but as the first oxygen molecule binds, it will change the shape of the hemoglobin molecule slightly. So the change in this hemoglobin molecule subsequently, it binds to the, subsequently what happens, second and third oxygen molecules bind to the hemoglobin. So that the binding of later molecules, later oxygen molecules will become easier. So this is called as cooperative. So full saturation with the fourth molecule becomes more difficult, as only one free binding site remains. So in this way, initial first oxygen molecule binding will be very difficult, but second and third molecules binding will be very easier, and again the fourth oxygen molecule binding will be difficult. In this diagram, we can see that the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. This dissociation curve gives us the idea of under what conditions the hemoglobin is dissociating with this oxyhemoglobin. Oxygen is how the oxygen is dissociating or separating from this oxyhemoglobin. So this oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve can be used for inferring data or information of how the oxygen is being liberated to the cells. So in this diagram, in constructing this oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve, we take a graph paper on x bar, we will take oxygen partial pressures, and oxygen partial pressures values would be around 0 to 120. So in the atmospheric air, 21% of 760 mm/Hg would be around 120 mm/Hg. So 0 to 120 mm/Hg values will be mentioned on X line. And on Y, and on Y bar, we will take a percentage of hemoglobin saturation. And these saturation levels also will vary from 0 to 100%. So when we say a hemoglobin molecule is 100% saturated, we know that one hemoglobin molecule can bind with four oxygen molecules. So when all the hemoglobin molecules that came to lungs, when all of them bind to four oxygen molecules, each hemoglobin molecule, if it binds to four oxygen molecules, then all hemoglobin molecules are fully saturated. So then we will say that oxygen saturation is 100%. When only 50% of hemoglobin molecules are satisfied or saturated, that means if all the hemoglobin molecules are bind to only two oxygen molecules, then we say that the oxygen saturation is 50%. So in this way, oxygen partial pressures, they have a correlation with this oxygen saturation of the hemoglobin. So in this diagram, we can see that in the initial phase, this in the lag phase, and in this exponential phase, very rapidly oxygen can be bind to hemoglobin. Whereas once the oxygen partial pressure is increased above the 80 level, what happens? The oxygen partial pressure, even though it is increased, oxyhemoglobin saturation will not be differ very greatly. So in this way, when oxygen partial pressure is 80, around 95.8% of saturation will be done. So under any normal conditions, 100% of saturation will not be done. Only 95.8% something around this value will be the oxyhemoglobin saturation. Hemoglobin saturation with oxygen will be around this value. So, and at 26.8 mm/Hg, at this oxygen partial pressure value, the hemoglobin dissociation will be around 50%. That means only 50% of hemoglobin will be saturated with oxygen. That means this value, 95.8 of saturation, will be at the lungs after the exchange of gases takes place. So this 95.8% of saturated hemoglobin returns to the tissues. When it reaches the tissues, as we have already talked about, the partial pressure of tissues will be around, oxygen partial pressure of tissues will be around 40 mm/Hg. So in this way, when there is a big difference in the partial pressure at the tissues, the oxygen dissociation curve moves this side, left side. So when this moves left side, that means what is happening? Hemoglobin, oxyhemoglobin is dissociating and it is releasing oxygen, and released oxygen enters into the tissue. So oxygen cannot enter into the tissues on its own. Only when it dissociates from the hemoglobin molecule, then only it will be freed. The freed oxygen only enters tissues. So in this way, how the oxygen is binding to the hemoglobin and how the hemoglobin is releasing oxygen or is dissociating from the oxygen is explained by this oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. So this oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve will be always it would be in sigmoid shaped or S-shaped, and it relates the fact that binding of oxygen to the hemoglobin molecules is a cooperative process. And this curve describes the relationship of saturation of hemoglobin with oxygen at varying partial pressures. So at partial pressure of 50, P50 means partial pressure of oxygen when it is 50, P50 is a point where hemoglobin is 50% saturated. So at this situation, this oxygen dissociation power shifts to the left side. That means oxygen will be dissociated from hemoglobin. And this represents the increase in the affinity of oxygen for affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen in the pulmonary capillary. It requires lower tissue capillary PO2 to achieve adequate oxygen delivery. And in a left shifted situation, the hemoglobin is less likely to release oxygen to the tissues. P50 is reduced by factors causing a left shift, which result alkalosis. Decreased carbon dioxide, partial pressure of carbon dioxide, decreased concentration of 2,3-dihydroxybutyric acid, and decreased temperature, presence of hemoglobin rather than adult forms of hemoglobin, fetal hemoglobin rather than the adult hemoglobin. And right shift of the oxygen dissociation curve represents the increase in the affinity of the hemoglobin for oxygen. So in this situation, P50 is increased, requiring the higher pulmonary capillary situations to be saturated. So if a right shift occurs, then what happens? The hemoglobin molecule is more likely to upload the oxygen to it. Factors causing the right shift of the oxygen dissociation curve include acidosis, increased partial pressure of carbon dioxide, increased concentration of 2,3-dihydroxybutyric acid, and increased temperature. When these four conditions prevail, oxygen will be more readily liberated or dissociated from the oxygen. Then we say that this oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve is shifted to right side. So in this diagram, we can see that this blue line represents the normal, blue line represents the normal dissociation curve. When pH is lowered, 2,3-dihydroxybutyric acid is increased and temperature is increased and carbon dioxide is increased. So when carbon dioxide is increased, 2,3-dihydroxybutyric acid levels are increased and temperature is increased inside our body, and pH is lowered. pH is lowered means hydrogen ions concentration is increased. Then under those circumstances, this oxy dissociation curve, this blue line shifts to this side, and this pink line represents that thing. So then we will say that the oxygen dissociation curve is shifted to right side. Okay, so oxygen dissociation curve will be shifted to right side. It is shifted to right side, that means what? At 60 mm per Hg, it is giving off more oxygen to the tissues. And when these conditions are reversed, like increased pH, decreased 2,3-dihydroxybutyric acid, decreased temperatures, and decreased carbon dioxide level. When these conditions are prevailing in our tissues, then actually what is the meaning of that situation? Tissues are not requiring more oxygen. So then automatically oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve will not release oxygen. So as the oxygen demand is less, when temperature is increased, carbon dioxide levels are increased, oxygen demand will be there. Then temperature increase and CO2 increase results in the right shifting of dissociation curve. But when temperature is decreased and CO2 is decreased, the tissues, they are not facing any oxyhemoglobin saturation. Decrease in the oxyhemoglobin difference is not there. Hence, oxyhemoglobin cannot dissociate and it cannot release the oxygen. So that means oxyhemoglobin will stay in the form only. So it will not dissociate. In this way, when these conditions increase pH, decrease TPG, temperature and CO2s will result in left shift of the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. The meaning of oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve shifting to left side is that cells are not in requirement of oxygen. So oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve also, oxyhemoglobin also will not dissociate and it will not release oxygen. The tissues will show high affinity with oxygen. When the conditions are reversed, like lower pH, increased DPG, temperature and CO2, in these circumstances, cells are in high demand of this oxygen, hence the line shifts to that means more easily that very easily the tissues are really receiving oxygen. Otherwise, the more easily the hemoglobin is dissociating and it is releasing oxygen, and oxygen is made available for the to meet the demand. So this is the interpretation of oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. So by understanding this curve, we can know that how and when and how the oxyhemoglobin is dissociating and releasing oxygen. And it is in pure cooperation with this in demand study. And 2,3-diphosphoglyceric acid, this molecule binds to the deoxygenated hemoglobin and it reduces the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen and therefore ensures offloading of tissues. And the shift of ODC to the right side is called as Bohr effect. And entering the RBC, CO2 increases the production of H2CO3. And this results in this right shifting of this thing. This is so. With this, we completed our oxygen transport. Next class, we will meet with another topic. Thank you.